There's a nail up here in this platform. I guess that means nail it or something. I'm not sure what that is. Come to 1 Timothy, if you will, please. Good afternoon, good evening. Glad you're here. Glad you're going to be here all week long. You can't escape. They put up the bars and they have the guard dogs out there. They've dug trenches around here, filled them with gasoline and diesel fuel. If you try to escape, you fall into that, then we set you on fire. That's if those of you haven't ever been to camp before, this is your first camp. We didn't tell you it's a concentration camp. You thought it was youth camp, but it's actually not. It's actually boot camp. And so you're in for a real treat. Man, those things are bright. I want to talk to you tonight and kind of change gears just a little bit. Instead of just coming out right off the bat with a hammer, I just want to kind of get you to listen to me for a little bit. I realize that you're tired, you've been traveling all day, and you've probably been eating candy and doing all kind of stuff, and you're kind of like, hey, can we just go eat, play some games, and then maybe take a nap? A nap is about all you get right now for the whole rest of the camp. You sleep 15 or 20 minutes where you can, and then beyond that, that's part of camp. You don't get to sleep. But while you're awake, you don't bother old people. Because I get the last say-so, because when I get ready to preach, then y'all are in there. So if you wake me up while I'm sleeping, then old people get really crabby and grouchy. Have you noticed that? I'm an old people now. Y'all are shaking your head. That's scary. Y'all are like, yeah, you are old. You look older than dirt. Are you in 1 Timothy chapter number 3? Or 4, excuse me. Are you in 1 Timothy 4? That Bible says something to you about the last days. He said in the last days that there'll be many that'll give heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy. And then he says this, and many shall depart from the faith. Now I know the majority of your pastors, and I know that you know and clearly understand that once you're saved, you can't lose your salvation. But one of the things that happens that we don't spend enough time is that you're still open to spiritual deception. And because you're in a spiritual world, one of the things that takes place is that the devil is your enemy more so now than he was when you were lost, because now you're already headed for heaven, so he wants to mess up your testimony. And the one thing he would desire to do above all things is not to just rob you at the judgment seat of Christ, but the one thing that he would really like to do is to mess up your testimony, but to break your fellowship with Jesus Christ. I don't think that it is emphasized enough the importance of your fellowship with Jesus Christ. Thereon hangs everything else. Too often we spend a lot of time preaching about how to dress right and how to look right and what to listen to and what to watch and what not to watch and where to go and where not to go. I've learned that if you teach people to have the right relationship with Jesus Christ, he pretty much keeps them in the line where they need to be. The fact of the matter is when you generally speaking, especially you guys, but the ladies maybe not quite as much, when you make a decision to sin after you're saved, you know you're sinning. You don't trip and fall into it. The Holy Spirit has put inside you a special GPS system, and that system will tell you when you're doing wrong, even if you don't know the Bible verse for it. So when you sin, you play the thing out in your mind, and you decide to go ahead and take the risk. You decide to go ahead and weigh out what the consequences are going to be, and that causes you oftentimes to make wrong choices. Now, I am not going to treat you this week like little kids. I'm going to treat you like you have enough sense because of the amount of internet and television and other things you're watching and looking at, listening to, let alone you have good preachers that have rooted you and grounded you in the Word. I'm going to give you some stuff on a more of an adult level, but I want you to clearly understand as we get started tonight that the most important thing in your relationship in this world, next to your salvation, is your relationship or your fellowship with Jesus Christ. Thereupon hangs all of your success in Christianity as well as in life. So if the Bible gives us a word of caution about that, I think it's important to maybe go through the Bible and see if there are some examples or some biblical illustrations of individuals who got out of fellowship with the Lord, but you might think they would never be in that kind of a situation to have ever done that. Look, if you will, please, in Genesis chapter 3 to start with. Genesis chapter number 3, and I'll give you the illustration of one. To start, Genesis chapter 3. Father, we'd ask now that you might help us as we do our best to preach, and Lord, that it would not bore these kids to death, that it might help them, that you might get in what it is that we're trying to do. We realize, Lord, if you don't get into it, it's not going to help anybody at all. We pray, Lord, that they might be able, now that they've gotten away, that they can unplug for just a little while and maybe get something from you. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Now, as I read you this passage right here, let me ask you this. In Genesis chapter number 3 is probably the saddest story in all the Bible, next to the crucifixion. You have to realize there is a perfect man and there is a perfect woman, and they are in a perfect environment. And just because they're in a perfect environment, Jesus Christ comes down in the cool of the evening and walks with them on a daily basis, so they see him every day. He comes down in the cool of the evening every day and walks with them, and they name the animals and they pick the fruit, and they don't sweat because it's never hot. The humidity is exactly like it's supposed to be. There's no mosquitoes, there's no roaches, there's nothing that you could even imagine. They can lay down without fear of losing their life. No animals are there to molest them or to bother them. There's no suspects or bad guys around in the bushes waiting to kill them. Everything is absolutely perfect. Kind of like you feel when you first meet that guy or meet that girl. This is the one. Oh man, you know, you hear the choir of angels begin to sing, and all of a sudden you think, boy, this is it. You completely lose your mind. You guys are grinning more than the girls are. That's scary. Your eyes get all kind of starstruck and things like that. Notice what happens here to Adam in a perfect environment. And the Bible says in the verse number 8, "And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden, the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou?" Notice the first question that he asked is to Adam, not where are you because I don't know where you are. Where are you because you're generally right here having fellowship with me, and I'm not knowing where you are. I know where you are. Do you know where you are? Are you aware that in a very short period of time, in a perfect environment, because you listened to what was at that time a perfect woman, you decided to choose her over choosing me, and now when I come walking, you have never known fear, and now all of a sudden you know fear. Why are you hiding from me? In that next verse, you know what he says? I hid myself because I was what? Afraid. Let me try to paint the picture for you this way. There was a decision that Adam made that caused him to separate his relationship, his fellowship with the Lord who was walking with him in the cool of the garden. Why? He made a bad choice. Eve is over there looking at the tree one day. I don't believe happened in the spur of the moment, just like we read it in the Bible. She saw the fruit and then she ate the fruit and then it was over with. I think on a regular basis she went out there and looked at that fruit on that tree and thought to herself, well, that sure does look good, and I sure don't understand why God wouldn't let me have it. It just kind of seems like God's being selfish, because ultimately that's what the devil is accusing God of being. He's accusing him of being selfish and self-centered. He's basically saying, listen, God knew that if he gave you this fruit that you would be like gods, and he doesn't want you to succeed. He doesn't want you to be successful. So here's what I want you to do. Go ahead and eat the fruit and you'll be like gods, knowing both good and evil. Eve begins to listen to what goes on, and then guess what happens? She partakes of the fruit. Now all of a sudden things begin to change because Adam walks up. Can I say this for just a moment? Making the wrong choices based on who you're with is one of the greatest ways to get out of the fellowship with Jesus Christ. You get emotionally involved, you get physically attracted. As you grow a little older, your hormones begin to change. You're watching all this junk that you're seeing all the time, posted all over billboards and all over the television. You can't watch a hamburger commercial anymore without it being sold with something sexual to it. You watch scantily clad women and men now. They're always doing different things in Hollywood to try to attract you by looking at your eyes, because she saw the tree was good for food. She saw it first. It planted an image in her mind. And so all of a sudden, she's standing there talking to Mr. Hampson and Ma, and he says, wouldn't you like a piece of fruit? She eats the fruit, and immediately she knows things she didn't know before. And the first thing she does is use her emotional attachment that she has to her husband to say, well, don't you want to have the same thing? The Bible says that Eve was deceived, but Adam was in the transgression. Why? Adam knew what he was doing when he followed after Eve. Oftentimes, when you get into a dating relationship, a courting relationship, we're communicating with letters or text or emails or Snapchat or Instagram or Pinterest or Flakebook or all the other foolishness that y'all mess around with, you get all involved because words are going back and forth. Can I tell you the way you get involved with Jesus Christ is because of words? Don't tell me words don't matter. Don't tell me emails don't matter. Don't tell me you can't get emotionally attached to somebody just because you're reading the things that they're saying. A lot of people say, well, what we do is we control it because we just let them write letters back and forth. You can write a lot of filth in letters. You can write a lot of trash in letters. You guys are looking at the floor. Now's not the time to pray. You can write a lot of foolishness without having a single page, and you can get emotionally attached to it. You can get physically stimulated by it because words create pictures or images in your mind. Well, so guess what happens? They're communicating there, and so she comes up, and can I just say that she says over to her husband, Hey, Adam, why don't you partake of the fruit? Do you know why Adam left the presence of the Lord? Because of a decision that he made. You say, well, it doesn't seem to be that big of a deal. Yeah, but I have seen many people that are no longer in church. They're no longer walking with God. They're still saved, no question about it. But they're completely out of church. They're completely consumed with the world. They've completely gone the world's ways. They've completely ditched everything that they had before. At one time, they were in the church. At one time, they read their Bible. At one time, they prayed. At one time, they were doing things in the church. And now they're completely gone. They're completely outside. You say, why? Because they made a decision. They made a choice. They decided, I'd rather have that over him, and they took that fellowship for granted, and just like that, they're gone. Can I say this as we start youth camp this week, as we're here for these next few days, that's the one thing that the devil wants to do to you Christians is to give you the idea, you can't make it, you're not going to make it, you need to just go ahead and get out now. The national statistic in Bible-believing Baptist, independent, fundamental, King James-only Baptist churches is 70% of those of you that are sitting here right now, by the time you're 18 to 20 years of age, you'll be out of church because you made a decision to leave church. You made a decision to get away. You didn't make a decision to go to hell. You just chose to say, you know what? I'd rather go out in the world. I'd rather go out and go to college. I'd rather go out and have a great time. I don't care if you go to college. That don't mean you have to leave Jesus alone. You know why Adam went out? Adam went out because he made a decision to follow the one that had made a wrong decision. One of the hardest things that you'll ever have to do in life as a Christian is realize that sometimes you can actually really care about somebody and they make wrong decisions, and you have to make the decision to follow the one that's always right, even though the one you care about's done something always wrong. And can I just tell you this? It hurts. It's like puppy love. They talk to me all the time, you know, kids, you know, they think they've had their first crush or whatever. They're in the sixth or seventh grade or whatever it might be. Nowadays, they're in the first or second grade, the way as fast as things are moving. And they wind up, you know, they think they're in love and that kind of a deal. And I say, well, hold on just a minute. It may be puppy love, but it's real to the puppy. I've seen a guy blow his brains out over puppy love. I've seen a girl hang herself over puppy love. I've seen a girl overdose on heroin over what people thought was just puppy love. It might be puppy love to me and you, but it was real to the puppy. You can't disregard the emotional impact that you have on other people. Can I ask you this question? If you make a decision to leave the Lord Jesus Christ, if you make a decision to walk out, if you make a decision to get out tonight, you say this is going to be my last youth camp, this is going to be as soon as I get back, I'm not going back to church, I'm not going anywhere, who would you lead along with you? Your actions have consequences. I'm not trying to be hard on you. I'm just simply saying Adam made a decision. And because of that decision, the Lord came up and said, hey, Adam, where are you? And Adam said, I'm over here hiding in the bushes. He said, well, what are you doing hiding in the bushes? He said, well, I'm afraid of you now. Why? Because I know I did something wrong. Why wait till Thursday or Friday to admit you did something wrong? Why wait till Thursday or Friday to admit I've made some bad decisions? Can I just say this? Every one of us here, adults included, everybody under the sound of my voice, has made bad decisions in life. The difference in those individuals and some of you is that they realized they made a bad decision and they came back and said, Lord, I want to have you to forgive me. I'm asking you, I'm confessing that to the best of my ability. Put it under the blood of Jesus Christ and help me to overcome those kind of things in the future. It is not a matter of never failing. It's a matter of learning from the bad decisions and don't repeat the bad decisions. Is this helping you at all, or are you already bored to tears? You know what you have to do? You're old enough now to be accountable for your decisions. You're old enough now to be responsible. There's a 15-year-old boy back home. He went out and shot a guy and got in a big kind of a tussle sort of a deal. And then he went out, he got mad, and he had a gun in his back pocket. He decided to go in and pop a guy or shoot a guy that was in a convenience store, a little Vietnamese guy. And he reached out there when the guy pulled a gun on him. It was right after Vietnam, 74, 75, right along in there, 76 maybe, an eon ago to some of y'all weren't even born then. But a long, long time ago, and he got out there and he pulled his gun out. Well, the little Vietnamese guy pulled out his gun, and so the kid shot him, hit him right there between the eyes, one shot, bullseye, dropped him right on there like a sack of potatoes. I remember we picked that kid up and so on and so forth, and when they had him in the interview room and we were talking to him and things, he was bawling and squalling like the little snot that he was, and he's crying and that kind of a thing. And they called me and said, you want to talk to this guy? And I came in there and was talking to him, and they were already discussing with him the crime and all the other kind of things. I said, I'll ask you a question. Have you ever gotten saved before? I said, I bet somebody like you grew up in church. And he said, yes sir, I grew up in church. I said, I bet you went to youth camp, didn't you? And he said, yeah, yes sir, I've been to youth camp. And I said, what have you been doing? He said, I've been running with the wrong crowd. I knew I shouldn't be doing it, and so on and so forth. And I said, well, if you're saved, then you know the Lord will forgive you for what you did. And he said, he will. And I said, sure, if you ask him and mean it, he'll forgive you. I said, are you saved? He gave a pretty good testimony of his salvation. He said, yes, sir. I said, okay. I said, well, why don't we get down here and pray, and why don't you ask the Lord to forgive you for killing that guy? So we got down there and he prayed. They had the whole thing on tape and stuff like that. And they got all that stuff, got through doing like that. And I said, okay, now if you meant that, the Lord will forgive you of your sin. He goes, can I go home? I said, yeah, to your new address, Florida State Prison in Rayford. Because you made a decision to kill somebody. You made a decision because you and somebody got in a tussle to take that out on somebody else. That doesn't relieve you just because you asked the Lord to forgive you. It doesn't relieve you of the repercussions of that decision. I'm saying there's responsibility for decisions you make. What Adam did right there cost him to get kicked out of the garden, never to return again. What Adam did right there got passed on for the rest of eternity. You come all the way down to Noah, then Noah and the seven that were with him get on an ark, but that thing started back there with Adam, and sin will continue to reign all the way until the Lord eradicates it after the millennial kingdom, after the great white throne judgment, and then when sin is completely eradicated, then we get rid of it, all because of one decision. Now let me ask you a question before we move to the other 10 or 11 of them I got for you to see tonight, but I won't be so quick with you. But let me ask you this question tonight. Are you sure you want to decide to get out? What is it it'll take you to get out right now? What decision would you be willing to make where you would rather get out than stay in? Some hypocrite in the church? Somebody that was mean to you? Somebody that was rude to you? Somebody that didn't do what you thought they could? How about this? Some girl who decided she didn't want to be with you or date you? Some guy who decided they didn't want to be with you or date you or court you or whatever. I don't mean to go contrary to your preachers or see you or email you or write you a letter or spray foo-foo juice on an envelope or whatever they do to get your attention now. But can I ask you a question? Would that cause you to get out of church if the guy you used to be with decided to get with somebody else? Mighty quiet. You know what you have to learn to do? You have to learn to take responsibility for decisions. You're growing up now. There's repercussions for what you decide to do. Can I give you another one? There's just a few of them here in the Bible. Adam went out because of the decisions. Right there still in the same book of Genesis. Come over just one chapter there and look in Genesis chapter number 4. Genesis chapter number 4. You know what I know? I know that I've been doing this long enough to know that there's a whole lot of people that are in the position right now that are looking for more reasons to get out than they are to stay in. One of the reasons that we do youth camp is because we want to try to reach you at an early enough age to get you to have the right kind of relationship so that when these things come along, you don't listen and repeat the behaviors of all of us adults for all the reasons that we've done stuff we shouldn't, and we try to give you a word of caution about it. Notice that Adam went out because of a bad decision. Notice this one right here, verse number 16. Make it 15. The Lord said unto him, therefore whosoever slayeth Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him. And the Lord set a mark upon Cain, lest any finding him should kill him. And Cain went out from the presence of the Lord and dwelt in the land of Nod, east of Eden. Now, let me ask you a question. You know what happened to Cain? Cain got disciplined because of something he did that was wrong. It started by being wrong with the sacrifice he offered. Now listen carefully to me, because he had an opportunity to get right before he went further than he thought he would go. He comes and brings his fruits and his vegetables and that kind of a thing. Abel comes and brings a lamb. Abel lays that lamb on the altar there, and fire comes down, strikes that altar, and takes up that lamb and burns it, and the Lord is pleased with the offering. Cain comes up there and brings the work of his own hands, his own righteousness and those kind of things, and says, hey, Lord, here's that. And I'm positive he brought the best of everything that was in his garden. I'm sure of that. He probably polished them and made them all look absolutely beautiful, had a gigantic fruit tray, something like you would see in Hawaii or whatever, had every kind of fruit, every kind of vegetable on it. It was absolutely beautiful to look at, and I'm sure that it would have tasted well if you ate that. And he brought it there before the Lord, and he said, Lord, here's the best I have. The Lord said, yeah, but here's the problem, Cain. It's not what I ask you for. I ask you for a lamb. Uh-oh, here's the caveat. Here's the problem. Here's the rub. Here's the problem. His brother's the one that raised sheep, and he had a problem against his brother. He was already envious against his brother because his brother's offering had been accepted and his hadn't, and so now he's angry with his brother. And so all the Lord says, Cain, why is your countenance fallen? And he said, well, because you took his offering, you didn't take mine. The Lord said, hey, don't you know if you bring the right offering that I'll accept yours too? Yeah, but you're asking me to go talk to my brother and get him to give me that. That makes him look more right than I am. I'm not going to my brother. The Lord said, Cain, that's not a good way to be. I'm not going to my brother and make that thing right. But the Lord said, but that's what I need you to do. Wouldn't you rather do that than go to hell? Wouldn't you rather do that than get a mark? Wouldn't you rather do that than all the other kind of things? Cain has no idea what's fixing to happen because of a decision that he's made to deny what God told him to do. And so Cain says, nothing doing, I'm not doing it. The Lord never hits his offering. They're out there working one day, sweating and working in the fields and doing all the stuff that they're doing, and all of a sudden they turn around there and Cain's got a rock in his hand or a hoe handle or he's got a shovel or whatever he's got in his hand there, and he goes over there and he beats his brother's brains out and knocks him in the ground. You would have never thought that that envy would have caused him to get so angry that he murdered his brother. Now, could I ask you this question before we go any further? Did Cain deserve the discipline that God gave him? He committed murder. Y'all are like, well, I don't know. Hypothetically, you know, I could kind of understand, I mean, why he would feel that way because of his environment that he was in. And, you know, he got dropped on his head when he was young. And he didn't get the educational opportunities that Abel did. And, you know, Abel was kind of the favorite of them. And God must have liked Abel better. So I can kind of relate to Cain feeling like that. He committed murder. Murder. That's how they say it on the shows nowadays, where you watch all those murder shows. He committed murder. You know what should have happened to him? He should have been killed. So you know what the Lord said? He said, Cain, why's your countenance fallen? Because you took my brother's stuff. I'm going to fix that. I'll kill him. You know what the Lord said? I'm going to discipline you. I'm going to do something worse than killing. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to cast you out and put a mark upon you. And you know what Cain did? Cain walked out because he didn't like the fact that God got onto him for him doing wrong. Oh, better pause right there. Watch this. Whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. Some of you, you know what's happening? You've already made a decision. If God gets onto you for doing something wrong and paddles your behind for doing it, you know what you're saying? He ain't paddling me. He ain't getting onto me. I'm not going to do it. You know what I'll do? I'll walk out. One of the things that young people and old people alike, I have a church full of people that are that way. And what is it? They don't like to be accountable for doing wrong, and they don't like to be called out. They don't like for the Lord to chasten them and to straighten them out. That's the greatest thing God can do for you. The Bible said, whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth. He chastens you because he loves you. That's an expression of his love. He doesn't just let you keep getting away with it, keep getting away with it, keep getting away with it, keep getting away with it. He tells you repeatedly, be sure your sin will find you out. Be sure your sin will find you out. Be sure your sin will find you out. You reap what you sow. If you sow to the flesh, of the flesh you reap corruption. You need to stop it. You need to stop it. You need to stop it. Don't grieve the Holy Spirit. Don't quench the Holy Spirit. Don't vex the Holy Spirit. Stay in fellowship. Stay in fellowship. He points it out to you through preaching. He points it out in your prayer life. If you have any at all, he points it out to you in the Bible. He says, stop it, stop it, stop it. I'm going to have to do something. And you say, nothing doing. And the next thing you know, you commit spiritual homicide, and the Lord comes in there with a whipping machine and knocks the tar out of you. And you know what some of you do? You say, you know what? It's more than I can bear. I'm out of here. I don't know why he doesn't punish her. Doesn't know why he doesn't punish him. They've done stuff worse than I've ever done. How come he's punishing me? Because he told you not to do it. You know what you make the decision to do? You made a decision to go ahead and do it and almost dare him to discipline you. And then when he puts that board on your hind end, you know what you say? I'm out of here, man. I had more fun before I got saved. Now I mess up and he wants to come up here and do that. You know why Cain went out? Cain went out because of the discipline the Lord gave him, and he deserved the discipline. Cain never ever goes and says, you know something, Lord, you've been gracious to me. You didn't put me in hell. You gave me another chance. You gave me plenty of time to get things straightened out. I don't care if you believe he's the devil's child or not the devil's child. The Lord let him live long enough to have another chance. He could have missed hell and gone to heaven, but instead of that, you know what he does? He's mad because God got onto him because he got caught. Make you have empathy for him. Don't you feel sorry for Cain? What a terrible thing. I've seen churches like that with people that come in, they just keep doing wrong, they keep getting chances, and then the Lord steps in and says, okay, we're done, no more chances. And they're like, well, I just don't think that. I just feel so sorry for them. Well, why didn't they stop? They didn't feel sorry for you. They didn't care if they ruined you. They didn't care if they ruined your reputation. They didn't care if they hurt you. They didn't care if they drug you through the mud. It didn't make any difference to you. I can't tell you how many kids I've picked up time and time and time again, your age, of kids, you know, somebody smoking dope for the first time. Somebody drug them into it. They're over there, and they happen to get caught. The very first time they ever did it, the other kid did it 25 times. Or drinking, or cigarettes, or fornication, or any other thing you want to put on the list right there. You say, why? All of a sudden, it's like, well, how come I got caught? Well, some of you don't get the same chances that other people do. I've seen Christian girls mess around one time and wind up pregnant. You say, it'll never happen, never catch me. Yeah, that's what the devil wants you to believe. And the next thing you know, you say, what can happen? That discipline can come in the form of a baby. You're not ready to raise a baby, and now you got to make a decision. And part of the world is putting pressure on you to go get an abortion. And to take the life. And, well, what's the big deal? Well, you better slow down there a bit, sister. He don't give a flip. He didn't care about you in the first place. All he cared about was satisfying his lust on the altar of your purity. That's all he cared about. That's not too straight for you, is it? If it is, it's about time somebody told you that. That's all guys are after at this age. That's all they want. That's all they're interested in. I got to pass a few words there. I don't care what they tell you about how much they tell you they love you. They don't love you. They don't even know what love is. They know one thing, lust. Satisfy me, take care of me, look out for me, watch out for me. They're stinking pigs and dogs. You hear me? You're better off to leave them alone till you're about 35, and then you might have a chance if they're maybe 45. You generally mature about 10 years ahead of them. Guys your age, they're complete idiots. I know they're all sitting right here. Just in your mind's eye, imagine them being the court jester or the court fool. Imagine them all having on these caps, these little pointed things with dunce written on them. With, hey, I look at stupid and have a picture of them, you know. I'm with stupid and have a picture of themselves right there. That's what it is when it comes to girls. Can I get a witness? Say, no, he's the one. He's my Prince Charming. Yeah, he's the devil in the disguise of Prince Charming. He ain't your Prince Charming. You know what happened with Cain? Cain not only made a decision, he didn't like the fact that he got caught and God held him accountable for it. And if he'd have been a real man, you know what he would have said? I did it. You know what most of us won't do? We won't say, you're right, I deserve the discipline. Several years ago, it's been a lot of years ago now, there's a boy up in Montana. He committed a horrible atrocity. He raped a mother and daughter and murdered both of them. And then after he did that, they took him out there to a prison there in Montana, and they were going to hang him. And he got saved while he was in prison. Whether people think he got saved or not, I believe he got saved. He got saved when he was out there in prison. And AFL-CIO came out, and they were trying to get a stay of education, of execution and all that kind of a stuff. And he came up and he said, listen, leave it alone. I want to die for what I did. He wrote a lengthy letter to the rest of the remaining family. He said, what I've done is wrong. I deserve to pay for what I did. I deserve to be killed for what I did. I raped and murdered those two individuals, and I deserve to go to hell for what I did. But Jesus Christ saved me, and I need to pay for what I did. You say, what is that? A real man. You want to know what a real man isn't? Somebody that won't own up to the fact, got me. I'm wrong. Jellyfish. No backbone. Backbone like a cotton string. Every time the wind blows, they blow. You say, what is that? That's Judas. That's self-preserving. That's I'm going to do what I want to do to preserve me. That's Ted Bundy. We studied Ted Bundy for a whole entire week, 9 hours a day, from his psychologist that went down and did all the interviews with him, watched interviews with him, watched all the stuff. 300 and something murders to his credit. What a great credit to have. That's not all the ones they took to court. That's the ones that we know about. And listen to that guy. This guy said, without question, he is a true psychopath. He will do anything at all to save his hide, but he'll do nothing at all to save you. The more you scream when he tortures you, the more he likes it. And he will use anybody under any condition for anything to preserve himself. And I think we have some psychopathic Christians nowadays. I've seen the same thing happen with women. I've seen them wind up messing up a young man like Eve messed up Adam because they want what they want, when they want it, the way they want it. And if he won't give it, then she'll wind up wearing him out until she wears him out and gets what she wants. Well, Eve, you got what you wanted. You say, what happened? The man you looked up to. I don't know why, Adam, it'd been a hard thing to do. See, we like the romantic side of it. I hope this isn't too hard for you because it's fixing to get rougher. Here's the deal. We look at the romantic side. Oh, well, Adam loved her enough to die for her. What a perverted way to look at that. You know what he just did? He spit in the face of the one that created him and said, I'd rather have her than to have you. You know what you have to understand about that Bible? The Lord Jesus Christ said to you over there in the book of Luke, he said, whoso loveth mother or father, sister or brother, husband, wife, and children, yea, his own life also, cannot be my disciple. Didn't say you can't be saved, but he says, compared to everything else, you should love me above all. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Well, the first commandment is what? Love the Lord thy God with all thy body, all thy mind, all thy strength was the first commandment. How come we've gotten away from that stuff? Well, I don't know, preacher. I'm making decisions on my own. I got free will. Isn't that an odd thing to you? Jesus Christ paid the price he paid that these girls just sang about so well. He just sang that, and we're shouting here and hollering, sister, taking a lap around the bases here. I like all that stuff. But I think to myself, I wish I could really get that to resonate in my heart, because you know what I do? When I see what he paid for me and how little it takes to move me away from him. Don't take nothing. What does it take to get you out? I'm departing. I'm out of here. I'm through. I'm finished. Why? Because I've made a decision. Because I don't like the discipline that he gave me. I don't like it. Mom and daddy hurt me. They paddled my behind because I did something and was wrong. Somebody else deserved to have it. 2 Samuel chapter number 4. Let me try to hurry. I don't know why. We don't have anywhere to go. 2 Samuel chapter number 4. If we don't cover it now, we'll have to cover it later on. So let's just dig in. Here's a good one for you. Many a Christian has fallen into this right here. 2 Samuel chapter number 4, the Bible says in verse number 4, Jonathan, Saul's son, had a son. That's on page 359 in my Bible if you need help. If you got an old Schofield. Jonathan, Saul's son, had a son that was lame on his feet. He was 5 years old when the tidings came of Saul and Jonathan out of Jezreel. And his nurse took him up and fled. And it came to pass that she made haste to flee, that he fell and became lame. And his name was Mephibosheth. I love the song of Mephibosheth. You know what happened to Mephibosheth? Mephibosheth has heard. He's been listening. He's been paying attention to the reports. David has been made king. And now that David has been made king, he's going to come in there. And because Mephibosheth is a descendant of David's friend Jonathan, and because that's a son, he's a grandson of Saul, that means he's next in line of succession as far as kings. And so it was very commonplace to go out and kill the next one in succession so it guaranteed you to be there. So Mephibosheth has been listening to everybody, and they hear that David is coming to the throne. And so what happens? The nurse grabs him, and she stumbles, and he falls, and he winds up crippled. You know why? Because of someone else that destroyed him. The nurse that was in charge of taking care of him caused his destruction. What are we talking about? We're talking about leaving. We're talking about departing. We're talking about people that wind up getting out of fellowship with the Lord. Why? Because somebody else hurt them. Because somebody else did something that crippled them up. Somebody else made them go down there and stay in that stinking place called Lodabar where the rats and the roaches are. Probably has pasteboard so he can slide around on the floor or something like that. Somebody comes and has pity on him every now and then. The nurse is long dead by now. Has pity on him, throws plates of food out there to him, and he eats scraps over there and fights the roaches and the rats for it. And in his squalor there and in his own feces and in his own excrement, his own urine, I mean, you can smell that stuff from 50 yards away if the wind's right. sliding around on that floor, bitter and angry and mad and frustrated. Why? He was only 5 years old. What had he done? Somebody else fell that was supposed to take care of him. Some preacher fell. Some deacon fell. Some woman in the church fell. Somebody did something to him. And guess what? Because of that, he's crippled and he's staying out. Can I say this to you, just sort of cut to the chase a little bit here? There's always going to be somebody in the church, some friend of yours, that's going to do something that's going to cause hurt and harm to you, but you better be careful not to allow it to cripple you and keep you from being where you're supposed to be. Ziba pulls up down there in the king's chariot, and he pulls up there and he's looking for Mephibosheth, and the guy says, go down there about 4 or 5 blocks and turn to the right, go across the railroad tracks, past the garbage dump, past the sewage plant over there, go down to the lowest part where nobody goes. You better not go down there by yourself. You're a pretty big fellow and stuff like that, but nobody goes down in that area of town after night. There's nothing down there but all the people that are no good, all the people that are rotten, all the people that are disinherited. Who are you looking for? I'm looking for Jonathan. I'm looking for Jonathan's son, Mephibosheth, Saul's grandson. Oh, you are? Yeah, what are you looking for him for? He's looking for him to bring him up because the king says he wants him. Oh boy, the word starts spreading over all that social media and says, you know what, the king's come looking for Mephibosheth. He must be going to kill him. We're going to have an execution. Ziba comes down there and bangs on that old door and that kind of a thing, puts a rag up by his nose, thinks he's in a leper colony because things stink so bad, rotten flesh around there and feces and rats and roaches and smells like vomit down that place. I mean, just hot, blistering day, and he's holding that rag up there. Here's a man of war, a man that's seen all kind of things, and the stench is making him have dry heaves. Back up in the corner, he hears the voice of somebody in there, and he said, hey, are you Ziba? And Ziba backs up in the corner and says, who's asking? He said, I'm the king's emissary. I've come to fetch Mephibosheth. The king told me to fetch Mephibosheth. He said, what does he want a cripple like me for? He said, well, he said he has need of you. I don't know what. You know what Ziba thinks? You know what Mephibosheth thinks? He thinks the same thing that he thought that he'd been told by all these other people. The king's going to kill you. You see how you knew? He knows the king's going to kill him. That's what he thinks. That's what he's been told. You know what he does? He believes what everybody's been telling him. He's never heard that from the king. I should probably close with this story, but I'm not going to close with this story because the king's not looking for you to kill you. He'd like to see you to come back. But you know what happened? You know what caused him to get out? Somebody else fell on him and crushed him. Somebody else hurt him. Somebody else ruined him. Well, you know the story. Ziba picks him up. He's crippled. He can't walk, and puts him in that chariot and lays him up there probably on a satin pillow, and he's just looking up there. The chariot's surrounding him on every side. All he can see is the sky, and he gets ready to go up, and he's shaking and trembling like he's having some sort of epileptic seizure, and all of a sudden those horses are pulling against that thing, and that thing begins to elevate and turn, going up that hill, going to the palace there, and he begins to shake and tremble, and he sort of slides on the floor like that, and old Ziba takes those two legs like tree trunks, like gigantic oaks, and puts those things there and said, what's the matter, Mephibosheth? He said, I've been up to the king's palace before. I'm going to fall out of the chariot. And Ziba said, you have to fall out past me in order to do that. The king told me to bring you. I'm going to bring you. You're secured in getting there. That's a picture of the Holy Spirit getting you to heaven because you belong in the king's line of heritage. He pulls up there. Guess what happened? It don't turn out the way he thought. He thought he's going up there to die. He hears those sandals coming down off that throne and coming down those ivory palace stairs there, and he hears them clopping down through that thing. He is shaking there, boy. I mean, like a leaf in the winter afternoon that will not turn loose, and it's just trembling up there in the wind, and it's trying its best. He's just shaking and shaking. He knows what's going to happen. He is so afraid, man. He's saying, I'm a dead dog. I'm a dead dog. He's going to take my head off. I've heard about David. I've heard him kill a Goliath. I know what a man of war he is. 204 skins for rewards his wife. I know what he's going to do to me. I know he's going to kill me. I know it's coming. I hope it's quick. I hope it's quick like that. And all of a sudden there's 2 feet standing there, probably with some jeweled sandals on, probably got some little red jewels in them, like kind of maybe shaped like a diamond right there. And he recognizes right off the bat, that's got to be him. And instead of feeling a sword falling across the back of his neck or a battle axe coming across him, he feels a hand upon his head, and he said, look up here at me. And he looks up there, and here's a man's man. Here's David, a man after God's own heart. Here's David that's there. And David says to Mephibosheth, he said, why are you shaking? He said, because I'm a dead dog. I know who you are. He said, yeah, you're my friend's son. Your daddy was Jonathan, my closest friend that I had. Your granddaddy was Saul. Yes, sir, I was next in line of succession. Well, God changed some things up, but I tell you what I want to do. I'm going to have you come in. You going to kill me on the inside? No. Been a while since you had a bath, hasn't it? takes him over there, and there's people pick him up there on a satin pillow, walk him up in there. They got a warm bath running. It kind of has a sort of a crimson color to it because the sun's beginning to set, and that red ball of fire is beginning to die out over the horizon there, and the rays from that thing begin to glisten off of that water, and that water almost looks red in color, almost like blood in that thing. And they take Mephibosheth down in that thing, and he jumps into that water, and boy, he's never felt something so soothing in all of his life. All those wounds and all those aches and all those pains and all that filth and all that stuff begins to just wash away and just wash away. And man, he don't even want to get out of that tub. He's feeling so good. And they put him, all doctor him up with cinnamon and aloes and all that kind of stuff. And he said, man, I got nothing to wear. What do I wear? They said, you get to wear the king's robes, man. He brought you stuff from his closet. And they brought him in there and got him stuff. The tailor runs in there, makes a few trims, makes a few cuts, and does a few things. And the king's son says, hey, man, you're looking pretty good. Let's take him over to the barbershop and trim that beard up and get him a haircut and get him to looking a little bit better there. And man, Mephibosheth is sitting there. He's thinking, man, I'm doing this. This is wonderful. I never realized you do this before you die. This is the last thing I get before my execution. I guess they're going to kill him. And he's there in the barber chair, got him a hot towel on, man. And he's kind of kicked back there. Just a moment, he's thinking, boy, this is what it'd be like to be a king, man. This is the greatest thing in the world. Boy, this is the best. And about that time, he hears the king's voice. Hey, Mephibosheth, he thinks. Oh, man, and fear grips his heart. Feels like somebody kicked him in the stomach, and the barber takes the towel off of him, and he said, yes, sir. He said, are you hungry? And he said, well, yes, sir. It's been a while since I ate a decent meal. He said, well, you're going to eat with me tonight. He said, well, I'll have a problem getting there. And he said, yeah, I've thought about that. And he said, and not only that, I've thought about the fact that everybody's going to know who you are because everybody knows you're a cripple. And he said, yes, sir, I'd be ashamed. I can't get to the king's table. He said, don't worry about that, Mephibosheth. What I'm going to do is I'm going to have you come in, and I'm going to have you seated as a special guest next to me, and I'm going to put your crippled legs under the table, and nobody will even know, and nobody will dare say anything because you're going to sit right at my table from now till the day you die. Man, Mephibosheth goes over there, man. He stuffs him his face with lobster and with steak and with maybe not lobster. But whatever his favorite food is and stuff like that, he looks like one of them puppies that got into a bag of puppy chow. His stomach's all swole out, man. He's falling over there. He can't hardly make it around. He's nodding off here and nodding off there. And everybody's dismissed from the king's dining room there. And he says, Mephibosheth, are you sleepy? He said, yes, sir. I'm pretty tired. I can't hardly hold my eyes open. He said, got a special room for you. Takes him in there and dumps him in a feather bed like nothing he's ever seen before, and slings open those sashes there. Those windows are opened up, and boy, that cool breeze begins to drift in there, man, and very gently the feathers and the stuff that's around that room begin to just sort of go back and forth, almost like a fan, like angels up there fanning him and stuff. And he looks out there through that sky, and he sees that sky looks like it's decorated, boy, like somebody just reached out there and put diamonds in the sky. And then all of a sudden he sees the big moon pop out, and he looks out across that courtyard and across that fountain that's there and that lake, and that moon is dancing across those ripples in that pond out there like somebody has encrusted that with diamonds. And he hears somebody playing and singing, playing a harp. And he pulls himself out to the window there, and sure enough, there's King David sitting out there playing a harp right there by that splashing pool of water. Mephibosheth, boy, takes a deep breath like that and smells those cinnamon and those aloes and looks at that palatial palace and thinks to himself, boy, this sure is better than Lodabar. But you know why he got out in the first place? You know why he missed all that in the first place? You realize how many years Mephibosheth could have been living like that if he hadn't listened to everybody else? You know why Mephibosheth got out? The same reason some of you are deciding to get out. Somebody fell, somebody messed up, somebody hurt him, somebody did something to somebody, that this and that and the other, whatever it might be. You know what he said? I'm out of here. I'm done. I'm crippled for life. And out he went. I'm glad the king went to get him. You know what the Lord is trying to say to Adam? He's saying, you need to come back. You know what he said to Cain? You need to come back. You know what he's saying to Mephibosheth? You need to come back. He wouldn't come back. You ever look in 1 Kings 19? You don't have to take the time to turn there. Let me try to hurry up here. I've only got a couple more hours before I finish. In 1 Kings chapter number 19. 1 Kings chapter number 19. And this is something you kids deal with on a regular basis. 1 Kings chapter number 19 is the greatest preacher probably in the entire Bible. His name is Elijah. He's a tough old bird. 3.5 years, he stays out by the brook of Cherith over there. The Lord feeds him with ravens, takes the ravens to bring the food to him, and has a bubbling brook there. And he stays out there all by himself, all alone, and just him and God out there all the time. And the Lord tells him to ride, goes to Zarephath, and he goes to Zarephath, takes a woman's last biscuit and takes her a cruise of water there. And then by the time you get to 1 Kings chapter number 19, you have to skip 18 to get to 19. You say, what happened? One of the greatest sermons ever preached in that Bible is preached on Mount Carmel. And Elijah said, let's do this. Let's see who's God. We'll fast forward it to 78 RPMs. He gets up there and Baalites come out and they try to make God God, and they Baal God or Baal God and all that other kind of stuff. And they can't bring the fire. They can't bring the fire. They can't bring the fire. And they're leaping on the altar and cutting themselves, and they're jumping up and down getting excited about their God. And Elijah's sitting over here. Nobody is saying anything. And Elijah starts to make fun of him and laugh at him and cut up with him and stuff like that. It comes his time to pray. 12 bottles of water come down there. And he gets ready to pray. And boy, lightning comes down and smacks that altar. And it burns up the sacrifice. And it burns up the rocks. And it burns up all the water and those kind of things. And everybody gives a big shout and says, okay, we're going to have revival. And guess what happened? The way that Elijah thought it was going to go, it didn't go. By the time you get to 1 Kings chapter number 19, the very people he's trying to help won't even give him a biscuit. They won't even let him in the house. He's all by himself. He's preached the greatest sermon that's ever been preached with a whole bunch of should have been converts, and nobody is converted. And they said, if you win, we'll convert. We're going to have revival. He's outrun the horses back in there to get into Jerusalem, and he's pulled up out there, and he's standing there. Nobody even wants him around. And his appreciation is he gets a letter from that stinking Jezebel. And you know what it says to him? I'll make you like my prophets by this time tomorrow, or my name ain't Jezzy. He reads that thing right there. You know what he does? Elijah goes out from the presence of the Lord because of discouragement and because of depression. Depression's a real thing. You say, why? It comes from having expectations that don't work out like you think they should, and then you get depressed, and you get disheartened, you get discouraged over the fact that it didn't come out the way you thought it. You didn't get what you thought you were going to get, and you get depressed. One of Satan's greatest strongholds nowadays is depression, because all you do is think about depression. You think about depression. You hear about depression. Every time you turn on the TV, somebody else is depressed over something. Everybody's depressed, so it justifies my aches, my pains. It justifies my illicit behavior, my wrong behavior. They're trying to medicate it. They're trying to soothe it. I'm not saying if you got it, don't do what the doctor tells you to do. I'm not a medical doctor. I'm simply telling you a lot of that stuff is because you just utilize it as an excuse because you want to get out. You know what happens to old Elijah? He goes out there underneath that juniper tree. He curls up in that thing. The wolves and the hyenas begin to laugh. The wolves begin to growl. The lions begin to roar. And they begin to move in on that old prophet. And he's like, Lord, just get me out of here. It is enough. Just let me die. I'm done. I did what you told me to do. I've been by myself for 3.5 years. I took that woman's last biscuit and you blessed her, and now you got me over here. You called down fire and these bunch of people don't want to do it. I'm no better than my fathers. Who said you're being compared to your fathers? Let me die. Suicidal. Great man of God. Great preacher. Suicidal. I want out of here. I'm done. I'm finished. The church ain't growing. The people ain't coming. They're not doing right. One trouble after another trouble after another trouble after another trouble. He didn't do right. She didn't do right. They didn't do right. I didn't have a girlfriend. I don't have a boyfriend. I'm not making the right grades. I didn't make the team. I didn't do this. I didn't do that. I'm done. Let me die. Don't tell me about suicide. I'll tell you about suicide. Right now it runs between second and third in the United States of America for the cause of death for teenagers. And stinking preachers have got their head in the sand because they want to act like everything is okay with you. You shed tears like I shed tears. Your heart breaks like my heart breaks. Your heart may not be as big as mine, but your heart does break over things that hurt you. And it's real. And you know what the devil does? He pounces on that thing and says, yes, it's real. It's just as real as heaven. It's just as real as hell. And you know what you need to do? You need to curl up and pull your bed sheet over you. And you need to just sit there and think about it and think about it and think about it until you have laid a strong enough foundation that we can begin to build a wall. And I can hide you behind that wall. And you can use that depression to shield you from God. Because God should have done it different. He shouldn't have took that person. He shouldn't have let that person die.
He should have given me better looks or better athletic ability or better intellectual ability. He shouldn't have done what happened to my parents and let them get divorced. I shouldn't have been molested. I shouldn't have had that happen to me. I shouldn't have got caught. They got caught. I shouldn't have been caught. All those things.
Until you got nice high walls now and you're sitting there under the juniper tree, concrete construction, and a tank couldn't break through that thing. And you know what you're saying? Well, if this is how God treats those that love Him, I'm out of here. Just let me die. And you may not be ready to take your life physically, but spiritually, you know what you say? I'm done with church. I'm done with preachers. I'm done with the Bible. I'm done with praying. I'm done with them girls. Everybody's singing. Everybody's acting so good. I know who they really are. I read their Snapchat. I read their sexting. I read their Instagram. I read all the stuff behind the apps, on the apps that mom and dad don't know about, and the preachers don't know about, and everybody else knows that I got, and they don't know I got. I know what they're doing in the middle of the night, and they're up there. Look at them up there singing and acting so pretty. And look at the youth choir singing, and look at the people playing. And boy, I wonder if the preacher knew about all them that are doing that kind of stuff. You know what? I've had enough. I'm out. I'm leaving. You know why Elijah got out? He got depressed. You say, why? Because of other people, the expectations he had, they didn't come up to the expectations. And he said, you know what? I'm done. The devil got a great victory there. Elijah won the battle, but he lost the war. Until at the end of that thing, Elijah finally comes. You know what Elijah does? This is so bad. After the Lord feeds him and waters him and lets him rest, you know what he does? He comes out and then he goes to a cave. A lot of people don't tell you that part of the story. Woo, man, isn't this wonderful? He means back in fellowship with the Lord. What is he doing in a cave? He comes out of that situation under the juniper tree and goes to a cave. And not only that, he's wrapped his face up with a mantle. He don't want anybody to see what's going on. And the fire comes and the earthquake comes and a big wind comes and the Lord says, hey, Elijah, I'm not in all those things. I'm not in the fire coming down there on Carmel and all that kind of stuff. You got to be close enough to hear me because I speak in a still small voice. You got to be in fellowship with me. Now Elijah gets it. And he whispers in his ear and he said, now get up, get out of here. Don't go back in the dark place. Don't go back in the hole. Don't go back in your room and lock the door and turn on the internet and turn on the television and turn on the radio and put in your earbuds and block everybody out and that kind of stuff and listen to your foolishness and all that kind of stuff. Don't go back in that cave. Get out. Take that mantle off your face. Go down there and throw that mantle on that other preacher. And he never messes up again. But you know why he went out? He's depressed. You know why some of you are going to go out if you don't get the handle on it? You're going to go out because somebody took all the chocolate off your peanuts. You're mad you didn't get it your way. I've never seen a more entitled generation in all my life. You think everybody owes you everything. If you hadn't got a cell phone by the time you're six, you think you're deprived. You're going to go call the president and say, I want one of them free cell phones. Everybody has a cell phone. That's the most damnable thing that's ever been created. Amen, amen, amen. Now that you have you just, well, go ahead and hate me now. You're going to really hate me by the time we're done. I'm going to tell you the truth, whether you look at me the way you're looking at me or not. You ain't even grinning at me. You don't make me feel very welcome right now. You say, well, man, you're like as serious as a sack full of rattlesnakes. Well, I'm telling you what messes you up. You know, you got to be talking all the time with your thumbs. You don't know how to carry on a conversation. Most of you guys don't know what it's like to look a man in the eyeball and have a conversation with him. You don't think you're going to have a conversation with a girl. You can't even look at her. You sit 4 feet from each other and send messages back and forth. What a coward. What a coward. Learn how to look somebody in the eye and speak up, talk to them, be straight with them, shake their hand. Not like, you know, one of them, oh, hi, how are you? Hey, you're a little like the loafers for me, buddy. Get away from me. I don't want anybody to get the wrong idea. Learn how to shake somebody's hand. You don't have to crush their hand. Learn to look them in the eye. What's all this kind of stuff for? You got a guilty conscience or something? Some of the women, some of the adults around here right now, you know what they're thinking? You're being a little rough on them, preacher. We ain't even got started. This is all introduction. If I only had you guys here right now, you'd think you were in boot camp. I'm wore out with this effeminate generation. There's a well-known psychiatrist that just came out with a definitive argument. I'm all about psychology and psychiatry, but it just begs the fact. You know what he said? He said this. He said, transgender men do not become women. They become feminized. That's what you're doing now. You don't know nothing about a rake and a hoe unless it's something you find on the street down there. You don't know the kind that grubs the ground, that pulls the weeds and stuff out. You don't know how to get out and work by the sweat of your brow. God help you if you get a thorn in your hand. You run around like a little lion wanting a mouse to pull it out of your hand. You're scared to death of what work is. You think everybody owes it to you. You're looking and finding for a government program to get in instead of going to work and earning it. Amen. Good preaching. You say, what are you doing? I'm trying to prepare your husbands for you. Honey, I'd just rather you be home with me all day and let's just collect our government paycheck. Well, by the time you go around with that, you'll weigh, both of you weigh about 400 pounds and have every disease known to man. You'll be in and out of the hospital and using Medicare and Medicaid to be able to take care of your physical ailments because you won't get out and move. Wiggle around a little bit. Walk around. Get in the sunshine. Get outside. Your idea of getting around nowadays is, I got up from my bedroom, went to the kitchen, grabbed me one of them muffin things and a sweet tart and a Pop-Tart and a Coca-Cola. Oh, God help us, we got to have the Coca-Cola because we need the phosphorus and the caffeine and stuff. And I sat down in front of that, and then I got my games out. And man, I was having me a time in them games and all that. You're playing them all in your room. You didn't tell the rest of you were playing games. You're playing in your head. If you had to pick up a sack of fertilizer, it'd crush you. You'd have to break it up into four little pieces and get a wheelbarrow to get a 100-pound sack of fertilizer anywhere. And I don't know what you're grinning about. You don't know nothing about making a bed or cooking a meal or washing clothes or ironing or doing a thing called a vacuum cleaner. They don't teach that anymore. They don't teach you how to cook anymore. They don't teach you how to go out in the garden and pick stuff anymore. I don't know why I'm on this, but I'm liking the response I'm getting. You live in an entitled society. Entitled societies always implode. Greece did it, Rome did it, and America is doing it. I deserve, they owe me. They don't owe you squat. You have a right to die and pay taxes. All your job is to do right now for your parents is to obey them, and your way of paying rent is you go to school and make the best grade you can, and I'll be jumped if I'm this idea of when you go to school, excuse me, homeschooled or not, just passing to get by. You should be excelling if you have the ability to excel if you're a Christian. That's if you're a Christian. If you're just a saved person, then just go ahead and get by like the rest of the world does. Get them to give you a diploma so you can act like you accomplished something. Why don't you apply yourself? You apply yourself, you know what will happen? You'll find yourself being a whole lot less discouraged and a whole lot less depressed. And I'm forgiving anybody anything that they earn, but I am wore out with this. You owe me something. Give me something entitled. I got a scholarship to life going on. How am I doing? Amen. Thank you. That was a pity, amen, but okay. Amen. Let me try to hurry here. I'm looking at the few of them I can cut out. I've really only got about 10 more here, but... Can I say this? I got to hit this one. You remember the story of Jonah? How many of you remember the story of Jonah? Hallelujah. That was actually a rhetorical question. Then after I asked it, I'm like, I hope they really do know the story of Jonah. Jonah's the one that got swallowed by the great fish. You know, because it couldn't have been a whale. Because scientifically we know that a whale's throat is about the size of a grapefruit, and if he swallowed anything larger than that, he would have choked to death. Yet the Lord said Jonah was swallowed by the whale. So it was a whale. It may not be the sharpest knife in the drawer, but I'm smart enough not to change what the Lord said. You know why Jonah went out from the presence of the Lord? I got scripture for all these. If you'll see me after the service, I'll give you every verse that shows, and they went out from the presence of the Lord. You know why Jonah went out from the presence of the Lord? He didn't like the direction the Lord was sending him. Now, Jonah must have been a great preacher. He's getting called to one of the greatest cities that was around in those days. A very wicked city, but he must have been a great preacher. He must have been a great prophet. He'd been itching to preach. Probably been in his preacher's face every day in the synagogue saying, hey, I want to preach, I want to preach, I want to preach, I want to preach, I want to preach. Give me your pulpit, give me your pulpit, give me your pulpit. The Lord said, you really want to preach? He said, I want to preach. I'll preach anywhere you want me to preach. The Lord said, good. How about Nineveh tomorrow morning, 7 a.m.? Whoa. I'll go anywhere but there. The Lord said, yeah, but that's where I want you to go. Well, but see, Lord, here's the deal. I'm a very gifted prophet. I'm a very gifted speaker, and I'd be glad to speak to people at the Colosseums and places like that, but I don't want to go over there. The Lord's like, so now what we're having is an issue. It's not a matter of whether or not the people near to hear the preaching. This is a matter of you don't want to do what I'm telling you to do. You don't like the direction that I'm sending you. You know what Jonah said? You're right, and I ain't going. I'm going to leave. You know what he does? He flees to Tarshish. You know what happens with the story. Jonah winds up out there, and then a bad storm comes up. Jonah's sound asleep in the bottom of the ship, and those kind of things. Nobody can wake him up. Everybody's having all kind of trouble and stuff. Jonah's immune to it. Jonah's out of it. Jonah has made up his mind. No matter what God's doing to get his attention, he's not going to do it. Even after he comes down and says, it's my fault that's going on, Jonah never does accept full responsibility for anything. You know what happens? They pitch him overboard. By the way, God did that, not the people on there. And the whale comes by there and swallows Jonah and takes him over there and throws him out there in Nineveh. Jonah gets out, preaches an 8-word sermon, and the entire whole city repents. That's a great revival. He must have been a great preacher. 8 words, no megaphone, no Facebook, no way to put out social media, no CNN or Fox, no news coverage or nothing like that. 8 words from one end of the city to the other. Even the animals have got on sackcloth and they're not eating. The horses are like, hey, where's my oats? You ain't getting no oats, man. You're repenting too. You must have done something wrong, so you're going to repent with us. The cows don't eat. Nothing gets to eat in that thing. The people don't get to eat. The king's repenting, and they should have been having a revival. Here's Jonah. I knew if I came over here, they'd repent. I mean, after all, I'm that kind of a preacher, you know. And I wanted you to kill them because I don't like them. The Lord said, well, Jonah, they don't know their right hand from their left. You'd rather me kill them? Jonah said, yeah. I'd rather my reputation be preserved than them die and go to heaven instead of going to hell. I would rather me be preserved. God ever told you to do something you don't want to do? God ever told you to go to somebody and fix something up? You remember the story about John Mark? John Mark goes out there and him and Paul have a disputing there and those kind of things. And he says to Paul, he says, I think you're a little bit rough on the fellow there. You blinded him. You shouldn't have done that. And he says, listen, man, you don't understand. There's things about the ministry I know that you don't know. And he said, well, I don't think you should have done that. And from that day forward, there was dissension. There was a problem there. There was an envy. There was a division that was between them. You know what John Mark could have done? He could have gotten right with the Apostle Paul, but instead he spent 9 years out of the Apostle Paul's tutelage because he wouldn't get right. And God don't use preachers that won't get right. Over there in Matthew chapter number 5, don't turn there, I'm coming down to an end now. Matthew, I'm circling the airport like we did about 4 times before we landed today. Matthew chapter 5, verse number 40, the Lord says, and that's that passage over there about, he says, if somebody, you know, gets your cloak, a coat, you give them your cloak also. You remember that? But you missed the first part of the passage. If they take you to law, meaning you lost a court case, meaning that it was clear that you were wrong and they were right. He said, you've been proven wrong. Now you give him what you're supposed to give him, but then you know what he says? You give him your outer garment, your cloak also. You give him more than you're required to give him. You say, why? I hold you as a Christian to a higher standard. Don't dispensationalize that out of the Bible. You know what he says over there to Zacchaeus? He says, you come down here, and Zacchaeus gets right with God. The first thing he says, I'll give half my income to the poor, and if I've done anybody wrong, I'll give them 4 times the amount. You know what? God sometimes has told some of you to go make it right with somebody, and you'd rather just have your way and have your reputation than to make that thing right with somebody. And you want God to use you, whether it's to sing, whether it's to preach, whether it's to play, whether it's to witness or whatever. You know what the Lord said? Okay, I'll tell you what, John Mark, you can sit on the bench for 9 years because you won't go fix that thing with Paul. You were wrong, John Mark. You were wrong. And you don't have the backbone to tell him you're wrong. You got no courage at all. What kind of preacher are you? Jonah, why don't you admit you're wrong? You know how the book of Jonah ends? It ends with a question mark. Leave me alone, let me swallow my own spit. Jonah, do you think I should have done this and done that? And Jonah, do you think that you're better than them? And that kind of, you look at that, it ends in a question mark. You say, why? God wants to know how you would finish it. Would you be like Jonah? Some of you will be like Jonah. You know what? You get so mad because somebody did something, and instead of working the thing out, you get out. That's what Jonah did. You leave. Even after Jonah saw a great revival and had an opportunity to talk back and forth to the Lord and understand what was going on, Jonah never did get right. At least it doesn't appear that way. It ends in a question mark, even though the entire city did. John Mark went out because, I'm out of here because that preacher did something. I don't like it. Lord said, why don't you go talk to him about it? Nope. 9 years later, he said, I sure wish I'd have made that thing right. That man in Matthew chapter number 5 has been taken to court. He's been sued in a sense for finding out that he did something wrong, and payment for that would have been his coat. And he's been proven wrong. And the Lord said, give him what you're required to give him by the law, but if you're a Christian, you give more than law. I gave him what I owed him. Whew. Wow. If the Lord gave you what he owed you, you sure wouldn't be in too good a shape. I don't know why you're depressed this evening. This is an encouraging message. You say, what is it? All these illustrations in the Bible that show us where we are and what we're doing and where we live. The devil-possessed man of Gadarene went out because the devil finally deceived him to the point that it took hold of his life. But I want to close with this. The prodigal went out because somebody had told him in the father's house about a place he had never been to and had told him that that place was better than the father's house. You know what he told him? There's a lot of fun to be had over there. There's a lot of friends to be had over there. You can make a lot of finances, money over there. Man, there's all the food over there you could possibly imagine. Man, somebody like you with that kind of an inheritance, you can parlay that into big bucks. Man, you can get over there. You'll be the talk of the town. And he was for a little while. Somebody had deceived him into believing that the father's house was a prison instead of a place of protection. Somebody had gotten him to the point that all he could wait to do was is give me the money I need and let me get out of here. I'm tired of everybody telling me what to do, trying to put parameters and blocks around me. I've had enough. And one day the father said, okay, it's your decision. If you want to go, I'll not hold you back, and let him go. The Bible doesn't say how long he stayed after he spent everything. You know the story better than I do. He doesn't even have enough money to be able to pay for food for him to eat. And he's out slopping hogs, walking around in that muck and that mire, that sewage, nasty, stinking hogs. And he said, man, I want to know this. These pigs eat better than me. And he's skin and bones now. Got sores all over him, infection, flies buzzing around, can't wait to him to die so they can land and lay maggots on him. He stinks, gaunt, eyes sunk back in his head. He sits there on the edge of that hog trough one day and he said, man, I tell you what, I sure do wish I could go back and just be like one of my father's servants, because you know why? They got plenty of food to eat. I paint the picture a little bit different than a lot of people do. I think the father, every day, he went up and got into his room, and maybe that candle began to flicker in the evening sun as the sun dove down over the horizon before he had his last meal and then got ready to go to bed. He'd get down on his knees and open those windows and look down that long road as the twilight began to come on and say, Lord, could you please send him home? Could you please send him home? Could you please send him home? You know what the Lord wants you to do? He don't ever want you to leave. And some of you here are at camp. You've already made up your mind. You're planning on leaving and you're looking for a reason to justify it. I submit to you that the prodigal left the father's house long before he physically left the father's house. He'd had enough. He had justified it in his mind. I know exactly what I'm going to do, and I know why I'm going to do it. And then all of a sudden, that stronghold, that thought, those perverse things running through his mind of all the fun he could have and all the joy that it would bring him and all those kind of things that began to develop so that his dad would try to warn him and he couldn't hear him. Because when you get that stronghold, you can't hear God talking to you. It doesn't make sense to you. It all just kind of seems like two styrofoam lids running together. It blocks you out. The devil literally gets between you and what can help you. You don't want to hear it. You hear Amazing Grace, and you hear Blessed Assurance, and it's like, tsk. But boy, that music from the far country, it sure does seem to tag you now. And boy, I'm going to tell you what, you can sing Just As I Am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and it doesn't grab you, but man, you can turn on that radio, and it can lift your spirits just like that. You can open up your Bible and look into that Bible and go, oh yeah, whatever. Boy, you can flip on that computer and you can play a game or watch TV and it'll bring joy to your heart just like that. And you're in the Father's house. But you're getting ready to get out. You're already planning your escape. You used to could sleep and enjoy having a little bit of rest and get up and have time around the family, but now you can't wait to ditch that family. The only time you have a good time is when you're around your friends, and your friends ain't in the church. They're those other friends, those even electronic friends. But boy, they sure do make you feel special, and they sure do make you feel good about yourself, and there's just something that makes your heart leap. You know what the Lord is saying to you tonight? At the beginning of camp, not at the end, don't leave. Don't leave. You've already gone. Why don't you come home? Why don't you come home? Don't go out like all of those other ones went out. Don't assume you're going to make it back. Time doesn't permit tonight, but I could tell you of many Christians, many church members, many deacons, many song leaders, many choir members, many preachers, many evangelists who left for the far country, and they're still there. They're still there. You say, why? They decided I can figure a way to get out. And that little thing eventually became a big thing. And now all of a sudden, instead of the Lord trying to warn them because they love him, they think the Lord just warning them because he wants to whip them. And they're out. I'm saying that before you get out, why don't you come back? You're at youth camp for a reason, maybe to have fun, maybe to play football, maybe to play whatever games you play at night, maybe to swim, maybe to meet girls, maybe to meet guys. I'm not stupid. Y'all are in really bad shape, though. There's really not much here for you. Just telling you. Sorry. Can I ask you a question tonight? I'm going to close. Are you going to get out? The Bible says in the last days, many will give heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. The devil will stop at nothing just to get you out of the house for a little while, to mess you up and laugh at the Lord, and you'll still go home to heaven. You'll still be saved. But you won't go back in the condition that you could have gone in if you'd never left. He wants you out. He wants you out right now. He'll even let something as silly as the sound of my voice or the way that I preach just irritate you to no end. You're like, man, I can't wish that guy just shut up. He just, he just irritates me. I want to get out of here. Boy, you can turn on those foul mouth, foul talking, sleazy talking, bringing up illicit things, and you can listen to him talk, and it sounds like butter melting on a hot biscuit. You've gotten accustomed to listening to all the slang and all the filth and all the cussing. Don't even make you blush anymore. Matter of fact, let the right set of circumstance come up. It'll show up in a text. It'll show up in your vocabulary. even at church camp. Just a couple of little, and then everybody's like, oh, everybody says it, we just don't say it around them. You know what you're saying? If you listen to yourself, I'm already in departing. A seducing spirit is telling me, come on. And the Holy Spirit is telling you, come back. Come back. It's okay with the preacher what I'd like to do. I know it's the first night of the meeting. I know you got some time. Sis, if you'll come play the piano for just a minute. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. I'm going to close. I'm going to ask you a question. Nobody's looking around. God spoke to you tonight. Don't wait till Friday night. If you're already thinking about getting out, your reason for coming to camp is not really the right reason. Come on, boy or girl, don't wait. We'll wait for the piano after a while. Young or old, adult, it don't make any difference. If God spoke to you, why don't you come down here to the altar and say, Lord, I want to stay home. Lord, I want to stay home. I'm bitter. I'm angry. I don't like the direction. I don't like the discipline. I don't like what you're... Lord, but I don't want to go. I don't want to go. I don't want to go. Lord, somebody else fell. Discouraged me. Disheartened me. I'm mad. I'm frustrated. I don't want to make it right with somebody else. I don't like them. As she begins to play, if God spoke to you, would you come? Would you come even now? That song she's playing is softly and tenderly. Jesus is calling. Calling for you and for me. Come on, the little ones are coming. Come on, guys, don't be so proud. Nobody's looking around. God spoke to you, that uneasy feeling in your stomach. Well, it's going to mess up my plans. Good, it'll mess them up for the right reason. The chorus goes, come home, come home. Come on. Ye who are weary, come home. He's not screaming at you. He's not hollering at you. He's not looking to beat you. You know what he's saying to you? Softly, tenderly, Jesus is calling. Come home. Come home. Don't leave home. Don't get out. Don't quit. Don't give in. Don't listen to those stinking, seducing spirits. Doctrines of devils.